Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank you, the organizer and the sponsors of this very important conference. It's very timely and very needed in this current environment. I think my task is to just briefly bring up two points. In this paper, these two points are quite opposite in terms of forces working towards each other in terms of forming a Thailand foreign policy. This paper is about Thailand's official and unofficial policy toward multilateralism and ASEAN in the future. I think. The first point is, of course, most of the experts agree that Thailand's official policy on ASEAN is moving quite successful towards the multilateral cooperation. This is not new. This, of course, is based, it's not new and it's based probably on the concept of Murray Chalmers' realistic look of the international politics. Thailand, as Madam Chair and the participants know very well, has maintained her independence throughout her history. So the awareness of her independence, her freedom is well documented in many, many research in the past. Having realized that international politics it's quite dangerous to serve her, to her sovereignty, her independence. I think it pushed Thailand to adopt different measures. Some observed that those measures could be pragmatic at one time and on principles at other times. It's a very complex policies for Thailand to move into this environment. This is not new. As many observers already noted, Thailand is not considered to be a major power. It is considered to be a very small player in the big environment. These pictures illustrated during the colonial period and present time that many people in Thailand policy makers included, consider themselves as in the dilemma, you know, of challenges ranging from the European colonialism to the new competitive environment, ranging, you know, from trade, diplomatic, security, and others. This picture is about the two confronting giants wanting a prisoner, you know, a top most wanted prisoner that captured in Thailand years ago. And they are working to push Thailand to hand over that top most wanted prisoners that are captured in Thailand. I think these are the pictures in the policies makers in Thailand. Now, of course, the situation is much more complicated with the move towards more, perhaps, if not competitive confrontation between superpowers. At the same time, the world is moving into a multipolar system for the last few decades. What Thailand's policy will be in this regard? There are a lot of questions. My short answer is that it may not be different from 1960s when Thailand is confronting as a frontline state during the Cold War, having realized that her threat, her independence, it is at the front line. Thailand, led by Kunthanat Korman, organized a meeting in late 1960s to make sure that all four members, original members of ASEAN, understand what's at stake. In fact, one of the great scholars, Professor Amitav Acharya, observes that Thailand plays a very critical, important role in creating ASEAN according to the new documents released by the archive. For example, the letter of the British ambassador from Thailand to the UK, citing the role of Thaputhanat Korman a few days before signing the Bangkok Declaration, as you see in this picture. So multilateralism is in the mind of the Thai policymakers from the beginning, decades ago, and it has remained a very important policy formulation, a priority. If you look at many documents, last year I was concluding a major research supported by ASEAN Center, Chulalongkorn University. We highlighted the different documents pointing out a priority of Thailand foreign policy with ASEAN in mind. I think this is very clear that Thailand, from adopting approaches, rejecting the forward US-based deployment offer in 1980s by US administration, or in the name of ASEAN consensus, ASEAN-led priorities. Right now, of course, the current focus is on the centrality. It's documented very clear in the Thailand News National Strategy, and the evolving regional architect has been in the mind of Thai policymakers decades ago, ranging from Khun Anan Panyarachun Free Trade Initiative and Khun Aphisit, you know, initiatives on ASEAN connectivity and others. This is very, very clear to the ASEP that we are pushing on this issue. So this is very clear from the beginning. The current objective is, of course, highlighted very clear recently by Prime Minister Prayut Chan-o-cha when he gave a speech at the Shangri-La Dialogue a few years ago, that the aim to engage at the multilateral cooperation is to create a new strategic equilibrium for the region. This is very clear. This is spelled out in the documents that followed that major speech. The first Thai Prime Minister and has been only one Thai Prime Minister that addressed the Shangri-La Dialogue a few years ago. I had an opportunity to listen to him in that meeting too. Of course, the current emphasis of this is to make sure that multilateralism for Thailand with ASEAN is based on three M's: the mutual trust, mutual respect, and mutual benefit, with the win-win cooperation and concrete deliverable, you know, results. This is a very clear instruction, Prime Minister initiative, you know, to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and many other agencies, that you need to engage and emphasize these values in order to move the multilateral forward. The result, as you know, AOIP is one of the major outcome during the chairmanship of ASEAN. It was low expectation, unexpected by many observers, that Thailand would be able to push AOIP in time during the Thailand chairmanship. This is one of the examples. ASEAN connectivities, Mekong global initiative, Greater Mekong, Mekong Lan Chang initiative, for example, Greater Mekong initiative, for example, are reflecting these policy goals and initiative. So I think this is very clear. My first point, Thailand and ASEAN has been working quite effectively in building multilateralism. Professor Amitav recently asked, can Thailand lead ASEAN again? I'm not so sure that we lead or we led ASEAN in the past few decades. I'm not even sure that Thai policymakers think of Thailand as a leader for ASEAN. But I think that Thailand would like to, in the future, move this multilateral cooperation in a much higher level of success with a doable real mechanism on the ground. You know, ACMEC is one good example. The very fact that Thailand engaged in helping to create a master plan in trying to perhaps be one of the country that donate and help some of other us.
Professor Panitan, we've lost you.
Yes.
Can you unmute? Yes.
Yes, sorry. This is not a leadership Thai style. I think this is, but this is Thailand initiative to make sure that we move to the higher plane. That's number one, one force, positive force that will move Thailand with ASEAN in the future. And personally, I feel quite confident that ASEAN will be strengthened, given situations in Myanmar recently, given situation in ASEAN during COVID-19 recently, given many new initiatives being proposed recently regarding these issues. I'm quite certain that given time, ASEAN could move again, as reflected by the importance of ASEAN in the United Nations meeting, the 5 points that adopted by ASEAN regarding the situation in Myanmar is a very good example of ASEAN is emerging, although slowed according to many observers, but it's becoming more important. That's on one hand. I have 3 more minutes, sorry. On the other hand, of course, I'm afraid that there's an opposite force moving toward this multilateralism, that is Thailand's strategic partnership with China. This is very significant, this is very important, and this is very much the forces that we need to analyze more. I think, of course, observers know that China is a latecomer, you know, in the international relations. That is very known. And China's Communist Party announcements on the role, the initiative of China in the next decade to come are quite interesting, if not alarming, by others. But on the other hand, on the bilateral relations between US and Thailand are much more complicated and much more problematic. Many of our friends in the past have been documented on this, one of the major research, which I will talk about it later, documented very clearly. But of course, these are the risks between Thailand and Myanmar, between Thailand and China, and between Thailand and US relations. For China, the increasingly dependent upon Chinese economy is a challenge to Thailand. The high expectation from both countries are very much a challenge to ASEAN multilateralism, especially in terms of engagement in the Mekong region and others, including the connectivity projects, BRI and others. The conflicts with the US in diplomacy, in technology, in trade, and in other issues going to be more and more complicated. But of course, Thailand is one of the only countries that operating the US military equipment simultaneously with the Chinese high level of, you know, military equipment, for example, submarines, high technology airplanes. You know, so it's quite complicated for Thailand, but so far Thailand is able, in my thinking, to balance that bill, but how long that balance can continue. And of course, the conflict with other countries in terms of the new issues coming. I think observers in this room know very well that once we are reaching technology level of 6G, not 5G, 6G, 7G, countries may have to choose whether they want to depend on one country and that what country will be, the United States and the West, or the China and the rest. So I think these are the confronting issues that can upset that strategic new equilibrium. On the other hand, you can see a lot of different perceptions and new generation attitudes in Thailand among the Thais toward the US role. There's mixed positive and negative, but increasingly some negative attitudes are being detected by different surveys, including Mr. John Blackland, Mr. Greg Raymond's major surveys on this attitude in Thailand a few years ago. I was part of that survey during that time also. So I think these generations may change the attitude toward the US in many ways. And of course, domestic politics and developments also take a complex challenges to a very close cooperation for the last 200 years, very significant security cooperation. And of course, the Thailand trade surplus will create more and more challenges for Thailand. This year, our rank in terms of human trafficking dropped to tier 2 watch list, for example. These are the challenges that may move Thailand to become a closer partnership with China. Recalling during the conflict years, Thailand did move closer to Japan during the interwar years. And this is quite problematic for Thailand in the past. So can Thailand adopt new complex engagement strategy, maintaining that balance? A lot of observers, policy analysts in the US concluded that Thailand is already moving toward China and more so. So this is a quite dangerous observation and perception for Thailand. If you realize the goals of Thailand to maintain independence and sovereignty and wants to be able to be in the middle. So I think my conclusion for this research is that how can Thailand is reconcile with different forces. In certain policy areas in the past, Thailand did reconcile with these complexities. The two interesting points, the Cambodian conflict, for example, in the past, and the new very complicated issues of the Australian, Iranian, US corporations to trade prisoners in Thailand, involving some suspects that are labor terrorists. But this may not represent the real strategic policies and issues as Thailand is moving toward a more very complex and challenging world. So I will stop at this observation, and perhaps I could come back later for question and answer. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you so much, Professor Panitan, for your very rich insights on Thailand and its role in ASEAN. I'm sure the audience has many questions for you later on.